Hi everyone and welcome back to the channel. So in this video we will be dealing with essay 800, which deals with special considerations when we are auditing financial statements which are prepared in accordance with special purpose frameworks. So there are about 8 key points as a part of this standard, and I've noted them down here, and we'll be dealing with each of these key points in a little more detail in this video. So you can just have a look at the key pointers before we proceed. Okay, so let's continue and let's start with their definitions first. So for this essay, special purpose financial statements means the financial statements which are prepared in accordance with any special purpose framework. And special purpose framework means this particular framework is designed to meet the information needs of a specific set of users and not the general public at large. So if you consider say the Schedule 3 of the Companies Act, which is a general purpose framework, or if you consider the accounting standards or IFRS, all these are general purpose frameworks because they deal with the information requirements of a vast majority of users. So it could be investors, it could be regulators, it could be the company's employees, it could be the management, it could be the board of directors or analysts or stock exchange, stock exchanges, and a wide variety of people. So they are general purpose frameworks. But special purpose frameworks are only intended for the information requirements of a specific set of users. For example, if financials are to be prepared for the purpose of getting a bank loan, so it need not be prepared in a general purpose framework unless the lender is insisting on that. It can be prepared specifically as per the terms of the agreement with that lender alone. So these are special purpose frameworks, and we'll have a certain we'll have a look at some of the examples which they have given as part of the standard itself. So you can look, they have given three examples in paragraph A1. The first one is cash receipts and disbursements on the basis of cash flow information. So this could be something which could be prepared for the purpose of creditors or lenders. The second one is the reporting provisions established by a regulator. It could be a central regulator or a state regulator or a sectoral regulator. So they could have certain specific reporting provisions which that entity will have to comply with. The third one they have given is financial reporting provisions of a contract. So this is between a contract between two parties, and they would require the other party to prepare the financials. So that as part of the contract, they would be wanting the other party to get the financials done, and each of them may follow the same contract for preparing their financials. And this is only for the purpose of that specific contract and those parties, and it is not for general public use. And the next thing that we'll have to note in para A2 and para A3, it says that even though that framework, whatever is coming as part of this contract or given by the regulator, even though it is derived from a general purpose framework, say for example, they would have to prepare the financials under the contract, and that whatever framework they've chosen under the contract, it could be taken from IFRS. So in such a case, they can't directly refer that the financials are prepared under IFRS, because it may not be fully compliant with IFRS. It may only have certain extracts from IFRS rather than being 100% compliant. So if it is not 100% compliant with the framework, they cannot say that it is compliant with that framework. And that has been discussed in para A2 and A3. And para A4 says that that particular financials may be the only set of financials which the entity may be preparing. So if the entity has not got any obligation to prepare financials under any other requirement, it will not prepare any other financials. But that doesn't mean that this particular set of financials is for general purpose use. It is only for that specific purpose and meant only for such specific users. Now coming back to the main standard, we'll look at the scope of the standard and the objectives of the auditor. So the scope and objectives of this standard is that the auditor will have to address certain considerations. They have given 3 points in para 5, and these 3 points form the key points of this standard. So they form the major chunk of this standard. The first one, 5A, talks about acceptance of the engagement and the acceptability of the framework that is being chosen. The second one, planning and performance of the engagement. The third one is forming an opinion and reporting on the financials. We'll have a detailed look at it now. So para 8 and the application paragraphs A5 to A8, they deal with the acceptability of the framework and the acceptance of the audit. So SA210 deals with the acceptance of the audit and the acceptability of the framework. So if you go back to SA210, they have given a specific paragraph there stating that what are the considerations which the auditor will be making to determine whether the framework that is being chosen by the management, is it acceptable in that circumstances and is it appropriate in the circumstance or not. So in this particular paragraph, para 8, they have given 3 points. That is, the auditor will have to obtain an understanding about the purpose for which the financials are being prepared, who are the intended users, and what are the steps that are being taken by the management to determine whether that framework is acceptable or not. So these three things are only related to the understanding of the auditor. In the application paragraphs, they give it in a little more detail. So para A5 gives the key point here as far as acceptability is concerned. So it says that if the financial information needs of that specific user is being met, then it can be considered to be acceptable. So the meeting of the financial information needs of those specific users is the key criteria for determining whether that framework is acceptable in the circumstance or not. And A6 and A7, they talk about the situation wherein the regulator has prescribed the framework. So in case the regulator prescribes the framework, normally it may not be acceptable otherwise, but since the regulator is prescribing it, it will turn out to be acceptable. And if there are, if the entity need not prepare financials under any other law or for any other requirement, and there are no contrary provisions or contrary things that are coming out, so the entity can still take this particular set of financials prepared as far as this regulator has prescribed. The same financials can be taken for other users as well. Only when there are contrary provisions that have come to light, that this regulator has prescribed the accounting in manner X, and as per the general accepted principles, it is in another manner, then it turns out to be contrary and it cannot be used for other purposes, or else it can be used for other purposes as well. But it still is a specific or a special reporting framework itself and not a general reporting framework. And para A8, it talks about the framework or the financials prepared under a contract. So it says that the parties under the contract, they can determine what is the framework that is to be used and whether it is acceptable or not. So in general circumstances, it may not be usually acceptable, but since the parties have specifically agreed about that, it may turn out to be acceptable. And the same example is given here. Now we will come to the second point that is given in para 5, and the paragraph 9 and 10 talks about that. That is, considerations when planning and performing the audit. So SA200 specifically requires that the auditor will have to comply with all the standards unless that standard is entirely not applicable in the case. So for example, if you take the standard on internal audit, that is SA610, if the entity does not have an internal audit function, then that standard will be entirely not applicable. So in such circumstances, the auditor may not comply with the standards. But in other circumstances, the auditor will still have to comply with the standards, whether it is an audit under the general purpose framework or under a special purpose framework. And the second one, SA315, it says that the auditor will have to gain an understanding of the accounting policies that are being used by the entity. And if the framework is specified in the contract, he will have to look at what are the significant matters or the significant interpretations of the contract. So significant interpretations, they have also defined that particular term here. An interpretation is significant when the adoption of another reasonable interpretation would have produced a material difference in the information presented. So if there is anything which is interpreted in one manner gives a certain type of presentation and interpreted in a different manner gives an entirely different thing, then it is considered to be significant and the auditor will have to be careful in such particular matters. We'll have a look at the application paragraphs as well. So para A9 to para A12 deals with the second point, that is considerations when planning and performing the audit. Para A9 again talks about the same thing, that he will have to comply with all the standards unless it is not applicable. Para A10 talks about any special considerations that are to be given to certain specific standards or adaptations which would have to be made. A11 and A12, so para A11 deals with the same thing, that is SA 320 itself, that is materiality. So what would be considered to be material in a general purpose framework need not be considered to be material in case of a special purpose framework. So if it is agreed between the parties in the contract regarding what is material and what is not, then the auditor will have to go by the contract and determine whether the transaction or that particular instance is it material or not. Then para A12 talks about the responsibility of those charged with governance. If you look at general purpose frameworks such as the accounting standards or schedule 3 or IFRS, those frameworks, they specifically impose on those charged with governance that they are responsible for the preparation and presentation of financials and they are responsible for such and such other things. But in case of a special reporting framework like this, such clauses may not actually be applicable. So the auditor will have to pay more consideration regarding the liability and also the responsibility of those charged with governance, whether they have the same level of responsibility or whether they are not responsible for such financials. Now we come to the third point, which is forming an opinion and reporting considerations. So under normal circumstances, the auditor will still be following the requirements that are given in SA 700 series as far as the opinion and reporting considerations are concerned. And the same thing is also given in para A13. Now we come to the last but one point of this standard, that is description of the applicable financial reporting framework. So if you look at SA 700, it has specifically stated that as part of the financials, it should adequately refer to the reporting framework. In case it is not widely known or widely accepted, it will have to also describe that framework in detail. So in case of general purpose frameworks such as Schedule 3 of the Companies Act, the framework is widely known and accepted. So if it adequately refers to the framework, that would be sufficient. But in case of special purpose frameworks which we are seeing in this standard, that particular financials will also have to describe that framework in detail. So for the user to understand how the financials are being prepared, that particular framework will have to be described to them. And that is what is given in para 12 and para 13. So para 13 states that in case of special purpose frameworks, the auditor's report will contain these two points here. That is, what is the exact purpose for which such financials are prepared? And the second one, if the management has a choice in financial reporting frameworks. So normally in case of financials prepared as per requirements of the regulator or as per the requirements of the contract, the management would not have any choice regarding the framework which they are planning to make the financials under. But in case the management has a choice, then the auditor will also have to give his assessment regarding how the management has arrived at that particular framework or how they have chosen that particular framework. And so these two points will be coming as part of the auditor's report, and the description of the framework will be there in the financials. And para 14, which is the last paragraph, it talks about alerting the readers that financial statements are prepared in accordance with a special purpose framework. This is something again which comes as a part of the audit report. So in an emphasis of matter paragraph, the auditor will have to state that the financials are prepared under a special purpose framework and their use and their distribution is restricted to only those specific users. So he'll have to clearly mention that it is not for the general public and neither is it for wide distribution. It is only for use of those specific parties to whom these financials are being prepared for. And the same has also been given in para A14, which is the application paragraph of that. Now we look at the illustrations which are given as part of the standard. There are two illustrations given here. The first illustration is auditor's report on a complete set of financials which is prepared as per the provisions of a contract. The second one is a complete set of financials prepared for the purposes of a regulator. So let's look at the key points of the first illustration here. So the first illustration, it says that the financials were prepared under a contract and it is a compliance framework, which means that the financials have to be prepared exactly as whatever is given in the contract. And the third one is that the distribution and the use of the auditor's report are restricted. So if you look at the audit report, so this is an old format. If you have the new book, you will be having the new format. So you can have a look at the new format itself, or you can have a look at the PDF of the new book so that you get to learn in the new format itself. So the financials have been identified here in the audit report. It says that it is we have audited the financial statements of ABC Company Limited, which comprise of the balance sheet, P&L, cash flow and the notes prepared based on financial reporting provisions of clause Z of contract. So the contract is what defines the framework, and it is the management's responsibility to prepare the financials as per that clause. And in the audit opinion, we have given that it is prepared in all material respects in accordance with the financial reporting provisions. So it clearly says that it is a compliance framework. And there is this one point called basis of accounting. So this will be there in wherever special purpose frameworks are being used. This particular paragraph, it only says that it is relevant or it is connected to paragraph A14 and also paragraph 14, para 14 here. So it only says that it is prepared under a special purpose framework and the use of this report or financials, it is restricted only to those specified persons. So you will be finding this paragraph in special purpose framework audits, and it only says that it is prepared under special purpose frameworks and it is restricted to those specified persons. Now looking at illustration 2. Illustration 2 is for the requirement of a regulator and it is a fair presentation framework. So if you look here, the financials have been identified and also the framework has been identified. And we have also identified the management's responsibility, saying that it is their responsibility to prepare in accordance with that section on that regulation. And in the auditor's opinion paragraph, we have said that it gives a true and fair view. So it is a fair presentation framework. And basis of accounting, just like I told in the previous illustration, we will be finding this wherever we do the audits under a special purpose framework. And that's about this standard. And with that, we've covered all the key points of the standard. We have covered the definitions, the objectives of the auditor, and the 3 points, that is acceptability of the framework, considerations in planning the audit and forming an opinion, and the other 2 points, which is describing of the framework and alerting readers that it is prepared in accordance with a special purpose framework. So with that, we come to an end of the standard. Thank you, and thanks for watching. Hope you also watch the further videos as well. Thank you.